Hello and welcome back to a second Fireside Chat. I am once again Josefin, one of the community managers here at Iron Gate, and I have with me today
Richard, and I'm the CEO here at Iron Gate.
Oh, and I'm Robin.
Who the f are you?
I do stuff here at Iron Gate, normally generalist stuff.
Never seen you before.
No. Not during these times. These times have been tough.
And the reason we are here today, though, it's because it's about a year ago now that since Valheim was released into the world. But the process of making this game, it started a bit before that. So we're going to look back to what it actually was before. Can you talk a bit like about how has it changed since it started, and how did it become what it is today? Do you ever like expect it to blow up the way that it did?
Well, definitely not. it's been a very long journey for me. It started out as just a small hobby project. I just wanted to do some research and experimenting with P2P networking. With my initial idea was to create a serverless MMO-ish thing. So I mostly just worked on backend stuff, and then I needed some. I got it working fairly well, so I wanted some kind of project to test it out on. And I thought, yeah, what about Vikings? And started working on that, and it became a pretty cool game early on with some building, and I found an interesting art style, and eventually I did a semi-public build, I think. We had a few players that played it, and I eventually figured this is a pretty cool game idea. Maybe I should just focus on the game, and I kind of forgot about the MMO part of it and figured I should just focus on making a good co-op game instead. And yeah, that's how it started out, and it was not known as Valheim back then. The first name was actually Fade, but Americans could not pronounce Fade.
Which means feud in Swedish.
Yeah.
It has a J in there, so it would be Fedged.
Exactly. So yeah, it was pretty awkward. So we figured we have to change the name. So Valheim it was. Yeah, I guess that's how it started.
And how did it start for you, Robin? Because you've been here pretty long, but not as long as Richard.
I'm not like the old dinosaurs from the beginning of time. It started with me going to football game with my daughter. And I mean soccer or football, depending on where you are in the world. And my friend Simon sent me a link from Facebook. It was on Spelutvecklarambulansen, something like that.
Yeah, it's a small community set up here in Sweden for game developers that needed a job, actually. Mm.
And he basically said, like, oh, this looks like something that you would like to work on. I was like, oh, it looks interesting. And the thing was, like, I don't like soccer, I don't like football, so I was bored out of my mind. So I took the liberty of just from my telephone, like, oh, I've got some portfolio stuff. So I was just sitting on my telephone and sending in my stuff and wrote something in English. And then a couple of months later, I was working at Iron Gate after the summer. So I started sometime in August, I think. 2018? No. Is it?
Or what is time? 19. We don't know.
I don't know. Time just flies.
Yeah.
I mean, I worked on a project for maybe a year alone before Henrik came on board. So I actually started the game as just a small spare time project. But then when I figured maybe this could actually become a real game, I quit my current job and figured I should start my own company. And then I talked with an old college of mine, Henrik, and he was interested. So we started a company together, and at the same time we also got a deal with Coffee Stain to work as a publisher. We have known Coffee Stain for a long time, and some of the people working there is actually old friends of ours, so it was pretty nice to work with them. And after that we started hiring people, and we hired Robin first because we needed an artist, and he was a good fit. felt like a good guy that would fit the team.
Yeah, and I think things from there is kind of what people know, because then the release, the early access release happened and things blew up, and 5 million in, what was it, 5 weeks or something, and it was quite a time. Like, does something of this this past year of early access, is there anything that stands out to you personally, or was there something that was like, oh, it, well, obviously aside from the amount of players, was there something else that was like completely unexpected and something that you think back on?
I mean, the first maybe 3 months after release was just a blur for me. I was completely shut in, you know, working very hard to fix bugs and fix network issues and stuff like that. So I was pretty isolated the first few months. It was pretty crazy.
Yeah, those times were, it was actually, it was nice because it was blowing up, but it was not, we were unable to contain, like we didn't celebrate anything or something like that. We just, I remember Richard, like, he was just working all the time, fixing stuff. I was basically the bug tester at that time. We thought that we had ironed out most of the things in beta.
Yeah, exactly, but the amount of players, and especially network players, we could never test that properly.
Yeah, especially things like, we didn't anticipate that people would love playing on dedicated servers that much, for instance. But that's one of those, I think that's probably the low point, I think, because it was fun that it was happening, but it was also a bit sad that we didn't have really, I know Richard didn't, he didn't have time to basically feel the celebration of being the success.
Yeah, I was just insanely stressed out.
It was a weird time.
Yeah, I think it was like maybe three, four months after release that we could start to actually think about the future again and start thinking about Heart and Home and so on. So, yeah.
But if those were the low points, were there any high points, though, even though you say you didn't have time to celebrate then, do you feel like you eventually got to celebrate some, or is that still like something that you're waiting for?
It kind of feels like we're still waiting for it, I think, because we have not been able to have any kind of, you know, public release party or anything like that. We have only had smaller after work like parties and so on. So I still hope we can have some kind of bit bigger celebration sometime after Corona, hopefully, before the world ends.
Like, it sounds like, oh, we're sad that it blew up. It doesn't have anything to do with that. Like, it's mostly like we're really happy for what has happened, and it has actually put a lot of things in perspective and forced us to see everything in a new perspective and figure out new ways to work, because we have so many more people to deliver a good product to.
Yeah, and it opened a lot of doors for us.
Yes,
I mean,
definitely.
Before we tried to just have an office, before we released the game, we actually got a new office because we kind of got kicked out of our old one. So we found a new office, a small office, the cheapest one we could afford, pretty much. And now afterwards, we can pretty much take any office we want. So that it changes stuff a lot.
It does. And but like I said, it was an amazing time, even though we didn't have the time to feel amazing. It definitely opened up a lot of doors. But one of the highlights, what I thought was one of the big things, it's actually that the princess of Sweden, our crown princess Victoria, and Daniel came to Hövde, where we work, and they wanted to meet us. Me and Richard went to see them, and that was such a weird, surreal thing.
We thought it would be like we would be one of many, you know, it's like some, they walk past us and say hi maybe, but it was actually a one-on-one dialogue.
Yes.
They are on one table and we are on another table, and it was not really what we were expecting.
No, it was really fun, because it was like, we did this on a Wednesday, I think it was, and we just got the information like on the Tuesday or the Monday, like the royalties of Sweden wants to meet you guys. Are you available? And we're like, of course we are available. It's the royalties of Sweden. So, but that was a very fun thing that actually happened, just because we made a dent in the market.
Yeah.
So that was one fun thing. Another thing was when we went to for the Game Awards as well. It was fun. It was stressful, but it was fun.
It was a huge thing.
It was a huge thing. You were there. You remember?
I was there.
I was not there.
It was. But no, it's weird. And it's humbling, and mostly it's weird.
Yeah.
It's mostly weird.
It's like, yeah, this is something that happens to other people, right? Yeah. Mm. Not me.
Exactly. But it definitely is, it's great. It's amazing. And there's so many things that has happened this year. Like, I didn't think we were ever going to. Remember back when we said we wanted to have some kind of animation sometime, but it was going to be still framed? But then when we started working on the Hearth and Home trailer, we got like full animations, hand-painted animations, like, oh yeah, nice. I never imagined us having that, for example.
Speaking of Hearth and Home, though, you said that we had like this period of just months and months bug fixing, making things smooth, making the network work for more than a few people at a time. But then we were finally able to start properly working on Hearth and Home. We got even more new colleagues to come in and join us. And like, the more we become, the more everything changes in the process too, doesn't it?
Yeah, I guess a bit, especially for me as a lead designer and project lead. I have to spend a lot more time planning and looking at the things the rest of the team are working on and helping others, and less time actually programming. So it's been hard trying to have time with everything, but it's fun. We can focus on a lot of different things at the same time, so that's good.
I mean, going from when we were back when we were just three people, now we're 10. It's a very different approach to many of the things. Back when we were three people, we would just like, basically, if Richard had a really cool, nice idea. Remember when we used to sit like for an hour a day in the mornings between 8 and 9 before Henke came into the office, and we would just sit and talk about stuff?
Good times.
Those times rarely happen, I feel. That's when many cool ideas came to life as well. It sounds like we're not doing any cool ideas anymore. I don't know when I say it like that.
But I mean, we also have the whole like working from home thing now as well.
Yeah, it ruins somewhat the workflow a bit.
But it's a different process now. And it feels like right now you have to come to the team with ideas prepared, because otherwise when you're 10 people, everyone has their own idea. And it tends to like wander off a little bit, which is nice, but it also has to be contained, and it has to be internalized and visualized as well. So right now it's more about like trying to think what is cool, what is nice, what is fun, trying to bring that to the table and like just slice it up and give it to the different departments right now. Which is different from before. Before it was like, Robin is this department, Richard is this department, but we can basically do a lot of the... Richard can basically do all the things by himself. But I mean, now when you've got like these specialized people coming in, it's... first it felt like more like, I don't have control of this anymore. But then you start to realize that these people that we have are specialists. They do a good job. They just need the direction.
Yeah. So more time directing, less time working.
Exactly. Less time working.
directing is also work.
Directing is also work. But
for me, if I haven't produced anything at the end of the day, it feels like I've not done anything that day.
I agree.
That's right. How I am.
You just want to sit in a cave and code.
Actually, I do. That's correct. It's when I feel the best, I guess.
And as you say, like since you can now, both of you, take on a bit of a directing role, That also means that we can kind of split the team to like working on smaller things, like, because our main goal right now is, of course, the Mistlands, but we're also working on a cave update for the mountains, and a couple of months ago we added the new monster in the swamps with an armor to that, and for the holiday we added armor stands. Like, we can actually have people like doing little things to the side while you can like focus on the main direction. Like, how does that feel to have to be able to do those kind of things now?
It's nice to be able to deliver more stuff to the players, I guess. It's something we wanted to do, but it takes somewhat focus from the main goal, I guess. But yeah, it's nice to be able to do that, and we want to continue doing these small content updates in between our bigger updates. The main thing we need to think about in the future is to maybe make them a bit less complex. We're working on the cave update now, and it turned out to become a bit bigger than we initially anticipated.
I don't think anyone's gonna be sad that it's a bigger update though.
Yeah, but it takes focus from Mistlands, for example. So yeah, it's a fine balance between delivering small updates and delivering big updates.
But it's also not as simple as that. Like, we do have layers to the production. Like, everyone can't start working on the Mistlands at the same time. You have to do a bit of pre-production, don't you?
Yeah, exactly. Like, we're working on this project very iteratively. we do a little part at a time. I mean, we have a pretty big idea of how the large parts of the game will fit into the whole of the game, but when we started working on Mistlands, we didn't have a perfect understanding of what it would be in the end. So we, I especially, and part-time Robin has been working a lot on trying to figure out what kind of parts do we want in Mistlands, and how will it stand out and be special, and how will it fit in with the rest of the game, and how will it be different, and so on. So yeah, we have to do a lot of groundwork before the rest of the team can start working on the update.
Yeah, so from what I remember, you basically started working on Mistlands as soon as the bugs from Hearth and Home were dealt with, and then you were working on the Mistlands while Eric, for example, was starting on the work with the caves.
Yeah, that's correct. So I've been jumping a bit between the different updates we are working on, but mainly I've been working on the Mistlands update and trying to figure out how to do these new special gameplay mechanics that we have never done before. I think people will be surprised by them. I hope.
It's definitely different from how we worked before. It's a bit scary sometimes as well, because all of a sudden there's a new thing and you have to go like, is this Valheim design? Does this fit Valheim at all? Sometimes we have to, because we have a lot of new people in the team, it's also about trying to teach them how to think Valheim, how to think Iron Gate Valheim.
Yeah, we also constantly need to think about what is Valheim.
Yeah.
We don't want to add a lot of content that does not fit with the rest of the game,
yeah,
the existing game. So and at the same time, we also want to expand upon the existing game.
Exactly.
We don't just want to add new content that's the old content with new clothes, so to speak.
Mm.
So it's a fine balance.
But yeah. I mean, just like with the caves update, we were doing that basically. So when we started with that, it was basically we're going to start with some Mistland production and the root armor with the root armor is actually a byproduct of the abomination, because the abomination was something Richard had an idea for way back.
Yeah,
so that was more like, we want to create a creature that surprises you in the swamps.
Basically we wanted a troll for the swamps. Mm. A huge creature, because we don't have any huge creature in that area.
Exactly. So the root armor became like this, maybe we should get an armor. But the whole thing, when we split into these, like, basically three different teams, is nice because we have something going on all the time. There's always something to look at, and hopefully it's basically some kind of training thing, because I see further down the line it's going to be more easier figuring out the Valheim design for the teams. They will come to understand a bit more, it'll go faster, and something that we always try to tend to think about in Valheim is try to keep it as simple as possible. Don't overcomplicate something. Don't hide anything. Don't try to do something that people won't see or understand, because that's just unnecessary work, because people will not appreciate something they don't see or understand.
Yeah, I mean, but if we look at a lot of the mods people are making, we often see mods that are focused on specific areas of the game, because players are very fond of specific areas of the game. You can have a player that's, or a mod developer that's very interested in, for example, inventory management, and they add different ways of expanding your inventory and so on. But for us, that might be a bit too complicated. I mean, we could absolutely do that, but it adds more complexity to the game that might not be necessary.
No, that makes sense. I think that makes sense, because it's never been about making the most deep game possible. It shouldn't have like super deep mechanics or deep skill trees or something like that, because that's not what we want.
Yeah, exactly.
Less is more.
Less is more. I always say, what would Nintendo do?
Yep.
Because Nintendo pretty much never release any game that's overly complicated.
That's a good mantra to have.
What would Nintendo? That's our lead star.
No, but it's also fun that we have the production to be able to produce as much as we can do right now. It's fun to be able to deliver these small patches, or big or small, or whatever size they are. They have to be meaningful. It's not about always producing something for the sake of producing. It has to fit Valheim. And this is something we've said several times before, so that's not something new to the community or so. But it just has to fit. Otherwise, it doesn't fit, and so it's not needed.
Yeah, and it's like you said, like you didn't throw in the abomination simply because you wanted to have something in the swamps. You threw it in because you wanted to have something that felt like the troll feels in the Black Forest.
Yes. It was actually never about the armor to begin with. It was about the feeling in swamps that we wanted to fix.
Yeah, we wanted to scare the shit out of the players.
Yeah.
I think we succeeded. But yeah, so we're working on all those like smaller in-between updates, and we're working on the Mistlands, and there's still plenty of work to do on the Mistlands. But do you have anything that you're particularly excited about now going forward? Could be about the Mistlands, could be about something even further on the horizon.
Oh, right.
Is it the secret air balloon up to Yggdrasil that people have been speculating about?
Yeah, definitely. No, but seriously, we think that Mistlands will be probably quite surprising to the players. It will definitely be pretty different to previous biomes in the game. We really tried to think about what don't we have in the game, and how can we make Mistlands different, because it's probably our last chance in the game to actually add a biome that's very strange and different, because the other biomes are probably for the experienced players, you know what the other two biomes are, and you can probably,
they're pretty straightforward.
Yeah, they're pretty straightforward, at least on the surface, but you can probably figure out what they would contain basically, unless we go crazy. But Mistlands is very undefined what it is. It's a misty place, probably, but that's about it. So we've been having quite fun trying to figure out what's the thing about Mistlands. And I think players will become surprised. And I'm pretty happy with the things we figured out so far. And it will be something pretty crazy.
What about you, Robin?
I would say that I wanted to keep expectations low for Hearth and Home, because I wasn't prepared. I didn't know what to expect. Like, there was going to be our first big update and everything. But for me, genuinely, I'm speaking for myself. As soon as we're talking about Mistlands, I'm just drooling. Because I think it's so bloody cool. I hope that a lot of people will think it's cool as well. I think, but no, Mistlands is probably the one thing that is really, really also fun to work on, but it's equally as fun to play for me. So I'm looking forward to having the full experience Mistlands, going in there, dying a lot. Hopefully I don't die too much in there though, but it does feel different right now.
Hopefully not too different, but yeah.
Okay, different is maybe the wrong word. Maybe special is a better word for it, because it's definitely a biome.
It is easily one of the biomes in Valheim.
It's definitely a biome. Yep.
It's definitely a biome.
But as we have said, we still don't even know exactly what Mistlands is going to be yet, since it's still very much in development. So while we know it's going to be cool, we don't know exactly what it is that's going to be cool.
The thing is with how we develop stuff, and it's something we've been trying to figure out along the way, it's that we like to test stuff. We like to have an idea, work on that idea, put it in the game, see if it actually works, and then we go from there. We find it very hard to just, you know, figure out a huge monolithic design from the start and then, let's just implement that and we're good. No, we try to do the iterative, one step at a time approach. So, and we implement one part and we see where we go from there. So that may be the reason why some things take longer times than you could expect, I guess.
But in the end, it's just because we want to make something that's as good as it can be.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. But I mean, okay, so what you can expect is basically you'll have the same type of progression that you had before in previous biomes, because that's something that's going to follow the rest of the game.
Yeah.
You come to a biome, you find the resource that you need, you start gathering these resources, you start making your new armor sets and weapons, and you try to overcome the new enemies and obstacles. And in the end, there's going to be a boss. So that hasn't changed. It's just the way that we want to maybe have you experience the biome. Like, a lot of people hate swamps. For the gloominess and the difficulties with the poison and everything. I did, once upon a time I also did that, but now I feel like the swamp is one of the more interesting places, because it becomes this kind of Tim Burton-esque place where you can build stuff, which I think is really cozy and nice, because it's always raining, it's always dusky and gloomy, and some people might dislike the mountains, or they might love the mountains, but it's also like you get like this penalty up there where you have the freeze thing going on, and the thing is, like, you have to overcome that kind of mechanic and try to how do I live and survive up in the mountains, which becomes interesting. So and I think a lot of these things that we have in Valheim, where it's like with the smoke and the fires and everything that we have, that there's always something you have to think about when going in or doing something or how you're building it. Those things make it more interesting all the time. The difficulty or the maybe the problem solving part of it makes it more interesting. So it doesn't, let's just say that Mistlands is not just a nice place to be in the mist.
not just for taking a stroll. Well, yeah, I think that is about what we can say about the Mistlands right now. So I am going to let you step out into the cold snow of the mountains and see what else we can discover before we sit next to the fire again another time. Thank you so much for joining me.
Wait, you're just kicking us out?
Yeah, in the cold.
I mean, you have warm clothes, right? It's the mountains.
Yeah, but
you said something. I could sleep here.
I'm gonna say goodbye to you, and we're gonna say goodbye to the audience.
Bye-bye, audience.
Bye, everyone.
Goodbye, audience.
Bye-bye.
Bye.